with your love and glory until your presence leaks out of us like a river. Oh God, we're just longing. We're longing for that fountain to just gush out of us, God. Shakaraba Santu. Thank you, Jesus. Whoa. Desire in them, Daddy, to bring home your lost children. Put a longing in them, God, to be your fragrance on the earth, Jesus. Put a longing in your people. Just put your hand on your heart and just say, God, make me a fragrance. Make me a fragrance. I want to smell like Jesus. I want your eyes, God. I want your eyes, Jesus. I want burning eyes of fiery love. I want your eyes, Jesus. I want your eyes. Just cry out for his eyes. Just cry out for his eyes. They can't resist his eyes. The lost children know. They know the eyes of love. They know the eyes of love. They know the eyes of love. Ask that Jesus would put his eyes in you and his heart in you. Shakariantai. Lord, that UK would be just rocked again by the glory of your love, God. Yeah. Wow. It's so dangerous to tell me to just start when I want, because I'm a worshiper. I'm a worshiper first, and I know I haven't even turned around yet. I just haven't felt like it. And I remember one time they said I could worship as long as I wanted at this thing before I spoke, and it was 2:00, and at 11 at night they tapped me and said, "Aren't you gonna speak?" And I'm like, "But you said we could worship as long as we wanted. You said it was, you said we could." And so, oh, so I just, and I did finally get up and share, and then we just went right back into worship. I think most of the people just stayed there that night. It was just, so I never forget that meeting. I just loved it. Somebody's thank you. Can I borrow that?
Yes.
You're so nice. Thank you very much. I like that we share. Oh. Oh, Shabbat. Wow. Wow. Is my time up? Hey, Shaka Mama. Hey, I'm gonna tell you a little story. Hey, when I was growing up, I wanted to be a dancer, and I studied from the time I was 8. And I studied and studied and studied and wanted to be a ballerina, and finally got in a company at the age of 16. And I remember the church, this beautiful church where I went away as an exchange student, and I was powerfully saved by the Lord Jesus Christ. The very first time I ever heard a message about what it was to be born again, I was the only one in the meeting that gave my heart to Jesus. And the rest of them were from, they were American Indians. And I remember running forward and the next night filled with the Holy Spirit. But these people told me that it was a sin to dance. And so I remember taking my toe shoes and just... I just like laid them on the altar, and I said, "Here they are, Jesus, for you. I'll just give you the thing that I love most, and I just give you these toe shoes." And I just laid them out there, and I was just thinking today as we were dancing about this time in Brazil when I've been dancing across the world really with the Lord's preaching this glorious gospel. And I've been doing that for both, long time. 37 years I've been preaching the gospel. And these ballerinas, they came up to me during this meeting where a glory cloud filled the meeting. This glory cloud came from the back, and it just rolled forward, just like, And thousands of people went bam on their faces. Nobody went sideways. All the people in the little vests fell out as well. There was nobody standing. Nobody on the worship team was standing. No ushers were standing. No mockers were standing. I wasn't standing. I was flat out. I preached face down. Hey. And at the very end of the meeting, there's these girls. They had danced before the glory cloud came in. These prima ballerinas were dancing, and I was just looking at them going, wow, that is just so beautiful. And they came to me, and they crawled very slowly, crawled. If you would have looked at it, you would have thought it looked very odd to see prima ballerinas crawling in slow motion, dragging their toe shoes. And they dragged, first of all, a pair of flat shoes, and they laid them at my feet and said, Jesus said, thank you. You're dancing with him throughout the planet. And then the next one drug up a pair of toe shoes, and she just, bam, laid them down at my feet and said, Daddy says, thank you, and you're dancing with Jesus. And I thought, wow. Back then, it seemed like such a sacrifice to lay those toe shoes at the feet of Jesus. And I thought, there was no sacrifice at all, because I wouldn't trade this life for anything. I thought if I had 1,000 lives, if I had even another breath, I would give it to Jesus. And I started to think about the things that used to make me feel like there was a sacrifice or a hardship or a difficulty, and I thought, oh, God, it's just so easy. It's just so easy because you're so beautiful. Like, what else would I want to do with this life? I had 3 messages on my heart, so Kate was like, 3 in 1. Okay, shock them all, see how it goes. Hey, nothing is a sacrifice when you're in love. That's what I want to say to you. Nothing is a sacrifice when you're in love. You count it all joy. It's totally true. It's all joy. I mean, I was thinking about just earlier, just dancing with joy in the river, thinking, what was I thinking when I thought it was hard to lay something down? It's just a joy. The lavish love of the Father puts love inside our hearts. We read about it in 1 John, and he takes our heart, takes that orphan spirit out, fills us with a spirit of adoption, and everything changes because we're free. We're suddenly free. Do you believe that? We're free to lay down, we're free to stand up, we're free to dance, we're free to laugh, we're free to give, we're free to be blessed, we're just free. I love the fact that God made us free. It's one of my favorite things about the kingdom, freedom. I'm a believer in freedom. I watch my kids, and we have a lot of children. I'm not teasing then when I say that. We really have a lot of kids. And they really are our children. They're not kind of our children. They are our children. And I think of the thing that brings me the most joy is watching the way they love. And every expression of each child's love is different from the other ones. Like, one child loves to feed people. And you watch them, they just feed everybody. Everywhere they go, they feed people. I have this one little guy. He's got club feet, and we've been praying for a long time to fix them, and God just touched some surgeons in South Africa. Shaka Baba. I thought, that's good. That works too. You know, that works for me too. And he loves to give away his clothes. He came to us in these shattered rags, like just rags that when you touch them, they fall off, you know? And he loves to give away his clothes. I always bring my kids with me. Sometimes I bring 14 of them. Sometimes I bring 8 of them. Sometimes I bring 12. However many I can squish in my truck with the other people I need to bring. And I'm always bringing my kids, and I'm watching them the way they love the people out in the villages where we spend 2-3 days a week. And I take them out of school because there are schools, you know, so shaka baba, it works. I just take them out and let them love the people in the village. And the thing that excites me is they know who they are. Like, they know that they're sons, they know they're daughters, and so they walk in a different way. Not in arrogance. I'm not talking about arrogance. They just walk differently. And it's not just their clothes that they're wearing. It's they know who they are. And because they know who they are, they do things that other kids in that village don't do. First thing they love to do is they love to take their backpacks full of their stuff. And they love to take their stuff out of the backpacks and give it away to kids that don't have anything. Nobody tells them to do that. They just automatically do it. They're like, yeah, come on, here you go. And they're walking around like, yeah, I have stuff. Shandai, I have stuff. But they're not like, it's mine. It's like, I have stuff, have it. And they give it away. It is just so much fun. The other day, Selmo, I always have my kids. They don't have badges or, you know, wristbands or whatever. They sure didn't pay to get in. And, you know, shaka baba. We're just out there. Most people don't have 2 coins, you know. So it's a little different scene. But these kids, I have them give words of knowledge. Like, I teach them by taking them with me. Do you understand? I teach them by hanging out with me. I don't sit them down and say, now, zippy na boca. You listen to me, you little rascals. And they are rascals. No doubt about it. I take them with me. And I say, whatever I'm doing, you get to do. Wherever I'm going, you get to go. Whatever it is we're doing here, it's all because of Jesus. And Holy Spirit lives in you just like he lives in me. So you guys get to do everything I'm doing. And they actually watched me with my backpack giving out stuff. You see, they watched the little things. They watched it. They watched the fact that if we give out food, we have more food. They watched it. They watched that as they give away their cookies, there are more cookies in the bag. Hey, some of you don't believe that because we're in a Western nation, but my kids know it's true. So they just reach in their bag and they just shundai. They just give out their cookies and they have more. Sometimes God makes more on the spot. Sometimes somebody just gives them more. It works either way. They always have more cookies. They're never cookie-less. Hey, this is a theological point. And if you really listen, you might want to even write some of it down. They're not cookie-less sons. Hey, another thing. They're not concerned about what God isn't doing. Here's my little boy, Selmo, with his feet twisted in. He gets up and he says, yeah, I got a word. He's about this tall. I got a word. Uh-huh. God's healing somebody's feet. Somebody's legs are getting healed right now. You're a child and you can't walk. He speaks with that much authority. Not arrogance, authority. He's like, mm-hmm. And I watch as a mama brings up a little child. Maybe we didn't know how old the child is, neither do the parents. Maybe 3 and a half, maybe 4, never sat up, jelly legs, dangling jelly legs. First thing, bam, a Selmo calls it out, and a little child with a mom, this child is now heavy for mom to carry on a capilana, on her back. She takes the child with the jelly legs and puts the child in the dirt, and I watch my son just like, oh yeah, bam, grab the little hands, and up comes the child. It's just like, yes, santo, santo, santo. It's just so, and Anselmo's not thinking, what about my feet? Anselmo's like jumping up and down. He's the best break dancer. Now, I never taught my kids they couldn't dance. We have dancing contests, Lord have mercy. Anselmo, if there's like 3,000 people dancing, Anselmo wins. He is a dancer. Inside his soul, he's a dancer, and so he dances. He doesn't let the club feet get in the way. He spins on his head, and he leaps in the air, and he lays hands on jelly-legged children, and they get up and dance. Come on. Santo Deus. We need to look with eyes that see. And we need hearts that feel. And we never, ever, ever, ever blame God. We just love him because he's good. I love this book, Colossians. And I'm thinking that Paul knew how to write this book because he received a spirit of adoption. He knew who he was. Paul found out who he was. He was knocked off a horse and blinded, but he got it. There are ways. God has ways with us. He got it. He found out who he was, and so he's writing this book. And he's saying, now this is a guy, okay, I like it. He's been shipwrecked. He's been beaten. He's been stoned. He's been ridiculed. He has been tortured. This is the guy saying, we thank God. I love this. We always thank God. He's been in prison, beaten, slandered. His own heart had to get completely transformed. He has gone through hellish situations. And he's saying right here, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you. He's not saying, why are they not going through what I'm going through? Why aren't they doing what I'm doing? Why aren't they getting up and out there doing more? No, he's just thanking God. Thanking God for them. Thanking Daddy for them. Thanking Daddy who gave Jesus Christ for them as he prays for them. He's thanking God, and he's heard about their faith in Jesus Christ and the love that they have for the saints because of the hope reserved for them in heaven. You've already heard about this hope, the message of truth, the gospel that has come to you. It is bearing fruit and growing all over the world, just as it has been doing since the day you've heard it and recognized. Did you recognize God's grace? When you hear it and you recognize God's grace, you don't spend your time either beating yourself up or not doing anything because you know you can't. When you recognize God's grace, you just start thanking him. You start thanking him for everybody around you, thank him for everything he's doing. You don't worry about the stuff that's not happening. You just thank him for what he's doing, and you just get on with it. Because you're his. And when you're his, everything changes. Amen. Hey. I think like Bill, I had some prayers that God really understood, even though they might have not been exactly what he would have liked me to pray. But for years and years and years, I would sob about how pitiful my offering of my life was. And it was genuine. I'm not kidding you. Everything within me was like, God, you're so amazing. You're so beautiful. And my life's so little and so pitiful. And I'm so sorry. This is everything I have. And I'd be like, God, I can't believe you could use it. But it's here. And here it is. Here it is. Here it is. I wish it was more. It's so pitiful. I hate to even bother you with offering it. But take it anyway. And I would pray that way for hours sometimes. And it was sincere. Everything within me was crying that. And one day God said to me, I like your offering. And I was like, you like my offering. It wasn't the wrong gender. It wasn't the wrong race. It wasn't the wrong socioeconomic background. It wasn't wrong. It was right for him. He likes my offering, which means he likes me. Hey, when I found that out, I was like, oh, he wants more. And then I didn't worry about what you thought. Sorry. No, I'm not. Don't say that. Zippy da boca. Don't say what you don't mean. I'm not sorry. Hey, what happened then was confidence happened. I'm like, God likes me. Cool. When you find out that Daddy likes you, then you're free to make mistakes. And which means you're free to try things that you wouldn't have done otherwise. Like, do you know how many times I've seen people get up, been raised from the dead, and I've seen people not get up. One of my most challenging times was when one of our pastors died, and he was in the morgue. He is in the morgue. And I get permission. Now, I don't blend at all. And I go into the morgue. I am going there now to raise this pastor from the dead in Jesus' name. This is my goal. This is my desire. This is what I'm going into the morgue to do, right? So I go in there. They're like, okay, you know, malungu maluku. Crazy white woman. Seriously, I can understand the dialects. Okie dokie. I know what they're saying. And I'm like, so yes, here I am. I'm just going to go pray for this dead man here. Don't worry about it. So, I'm walking past, and I remember walking past a pile of bodies, naked bodies, just piled up. They were just thrown there in all different directions, thrown there. And I'm like, oh, God. This is so creepy, but I'm on a mission. And I get to my friend, this pastor, and he's lying there, and he's really dead. Even in the Western world, you'd know the man was dead, like really just not breathing, stiff, and just there. And I am praying, I'm singing like, I'm just worshiping God in this morgue. And this guy just comes over and just tosses a dead baby next to me. Bam. And I'm like, I'm just worshiping. And I'm praying, and suddenly I feel this hand on this pastor warming up. I'm like, yeah, come on, it's hot. His hands, I can feel a pulse. I can feel a pulse. Oh my God, I can feel a pulse. It was my pulse. I was squeezing the man's hand so hard that literally my pulse was beating inside that hand. I don't know. I was there for a long time. Finally, they were closing or something, and I said, I've got to go. And the guy who tossed the baby met Jesus. And I left there seeing somebody dead in their trespasses, in their sin. Raised to life in Jesus Christ. Hey! He's good. All the time. And this gospel is bearing fruit all over the world. And the fruit is increasing. I told you I've been preaching for 37 years, so I've seen God do some amazing things, and I just keep falling more in love with Him. Makes some people upset, but I can't help myself. The more I get to know Him, the more I get to experience of Jesus, the more I love Him, the more I find out how Daddy lavishes His love on me, the more I love Him, the more I want to give Him. It's just the more all the time, the more. And in the midst of the more of loving God and receiving that lavish love of the Father, stuff happens. Stuff happens. Does stuff ever happen to you? I'm going to give you my really quick, short little version. My quick, short little version of getting blasted by God, you know, whacked on the floor and 7 days and seven nights and people carrying me around and never knowing if I would ever get up and not caring. I didn't care. It's like, if I'm quadriplegic, which I was, for the rest of my life, it's okay with me because this presence is literally to die for. And so I just yielded myself to that, not knowing if I would get up or not, not even caring, just being in that glory. And the things that God spoke to me, I heard very clearly, and I went back to my nation. And none of it happened for a year. Everything just got worse. Everything got worse. I mean, really worse. I don't want to talk to you about it because it's a long time ago. I want to talk to you about recent things. Things got worse, but I didn't give up. Things got harder, but I didn't give up. I just kept on loving Him because He's worthy. And I would just keep loving Him in the midst of the storms until the storms changed. I remember one time, I think this guy's called me two times in my whole life. He's a prophet. And there was, our nation had been slammed by storms, like storm after storm after storm. And our staff and our kids, everybody was exhausted. We said to God, we'll keep going, but we're so tired. And the news came, there's another cyclone about to hit your coast. And I remember hearing the news, and I was like, oh, crud. How much food are we going to need? How many trucks are we going to need? Like, who's even going to be willing to go right now? We're actually exhausted, like 18 hours a day exhausted. Of course we're soaking. We're soaking. We're soaking. We're soaking and going all the time. But we're tired, physically tired. And I remember hearing the news, and it was like, oh, another cyclone. God, just help us, you know, help us multiply the food, do what you always do, give us more trucks, you know, so we could feed 10,000 a day instead of 5. And, you know, I was just praying like that. And I got a phone call. It's by this friend, Mark DuPont. And he said, "Hey." I'm like, "Hi. This is Mark." I'm like, "Oh, okay." It's kind of strange. I was in Mozambique. Mark DuPont's on the phone. I'm like, "Okay, hi. Hi. How are you? Good. How are you? Good. I'm tired." He said, "This might sound strange to you, but I was praying and I heard God say you're supposed to go command some cyclone to turn around." I said, "Really? I mean, it's on the radio, it's in the newspaper, everybody knows the cyclone's coming. We've been slashed and bashed and slammed already by so many cyclones that it was around the world knew about Mozambique being slammed by cyclones. 40 days and 40 nights of rain. I mean, we were slammed and hit by cyclones. It had already happened. Now the prophet says, you're supposed to turn the cyclone around." I'm like, "Oh, really?" I'm looking at like me, like, I'm supposed to go tell a cyclone to leave, to turn around. So I'm like, "Oh, thanks. Okay, thanks a lot. That's great. Okay, awesome. Yeah. Okay, ciao." And I'm sitting there thinking, what if someone sees me? What if somebody sees me, like, doing that? I'm 5'3", white woman in Mozambique. I'm supposed to go. Where am I supposed to go? Anywhere. How do you command a cyclone to turn around? So I get in my truck. I feel so ridiculous. I've had inner healing, so you're not supposed to say you feel stupid, but I am driving down to the ocean. I get out of my truck. I'm looking around. God, please don't let anybody see this. Because, I mean, I feel ridiculous. I know Mark's a good guy. So, you know, just to humor him, you know, I just go out. I look at the ocean. I go, cyclone. Turn around. In Jesus' name. And I get back in my truck and I look around. Oh, gosh. I felt so ridiculous. Not only, back up a tiny bit, through the cyclones and the storms, we had led hundreds of thousands of people to Jesus. So if I had gone on my past revelation, I could have said, a cyclone's coming. Hallelujah. We are going to receive God's miracle power. Provision's going to come. Shaka baba. And people are going to be saved. But this time, God has another plan. This time, a prophet from America calls me. I get in my truck and tell that thing to turn around. In Jesus' name. Every newspaper, every television, every article, everything out said, we don't understand, but the cyclone turned around. It just turned around, turned around, turned around. I'm like, ah, Jesus. I'm like, God, this is amazing. I'm sure anybody else that was praying would have been just as amazed. Sure, there were tons of people praying. I was told to do it, so I'm like, I can't explain it to you. But when that happened, something inside of me just was like, whoa, wow, I can actually. actually tell a cyclone to turn around? Whoa! So now, I don't just listen to what's going to happen. I listen to Daddy. I say, Daddy, what do you want us to do? And if it's to go and feed 100,000 people a day and build their houses again, I say, okay, okie dokie. We're going to be a little tired, but we're going. And we just listen to the heartbeat of God. And we learn that it's listening and obeying Him and working with them that makes him really happy. He likes it. He likes it. So here's my current story. I'm a worshiper first, but then I'm an evangelist. It's kind of somebody else's there. That's an amen. It's a Holy Spirit kind of amen. Like, wham! He goes, wow, me too, yay! Somebody should pray for him and say more. So, Shundai, so I'm a first a worshiper, but then I'm an evangelist. So if I build a base, I can't stand to live there as soon as it has water and electricity. And, you know, if it ever looks good or the walls are straight, I'm out of there because I like to build and I like to go and I like to evangelize. So to get out there, and there's like tens of thousands going with me now. I'm just one of them. But because Daddy likes me, I get to keep going. That's really nice, because he could just say, you know, legacy, 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 just turn it all over and go live in England. But I don't have to. And that's encouraging to me, because God made me me, and he made you you. And you got to wear the shoes he asked you to wear. And not try to be somebody else. That's why when you're prophesying, don't try to prophesy what you want for somebody. Listen to God. Some people always try to prophesy me over to their world. And I'm like, God bless your little heart. I already heard what I'm supposed to do. You know, if God tells you, asks you a question like, do you want a nation? And you see three provinces. One, my province that I live in, Shakababa, 10 years ago was totally Muslim. 99.9%, whatever, Muslim. God tells us to move to this province. Missionaries told us it was an unreachable province. They just hated Christians. They killed them. We know that. I've been stoned many times. It hurts, but it's, you know, it's, we're dancing in the river. So, Shakababa. So, I'm just like all excited, and God speaks to me about 5 years ago. He said, in 5 years' time, this province will not be considered a Muslim province. I said, yeah. So then he says, now speak it out. That bothers some people here. Oh, is she like in the word of fame? Never mind what you think. God told me, speak it out. So I spoke it out. I told everybody, I said, God said in 5 years this will no longer be a Muslim province. Previous elections, every election, the shehas would lay hands on the ministers, on the governors. Everybody would come in Muslim clothes. They would all, that's how the government would be brought in, inaugurated. Not anymore. They said, your province, they said to our senior pastor, they said, this province is no longer a Muslim province. You're the lead Christian in this province. You come lay hands on the governor, the president, the ministers, everybody. You do it. Shakababa. Santu Deus. Yes. Thank you, Jesus. And they bowed their knees to Jesus. We did not go into that province reaching leaders, reaching government people. We went into that province as low and slow as you could go. Sitting in the dirt with the poor, which I still do. I have even arranged my schedule more to where more of my time is spent in the dirt, face to face with the poorest of the poor. That's where I hang. So if you think I'm strange here because somebody in a green jacket moved me, just get over it. Because my life is spent just in that place because it keeps me grounded. And I know that it's what he put inside of me. But in the midst of that low and slow, God has birthed a revival. Yeah. And now thousands and thousands and thousands and tens of thousands of people are worshiping Jesus as Lord and Savior. And that makes him happy. Hallelujah. But in the middle of that, it's okay. I'm okay. In the middle of that, stuff happened. And I'm sure it happens here. Stuff happens in UK, doesn't it? Stuff happens. So in the middle of reaching a province and believing the book and seeing God turn around cyclones and turn around a tsunami, they told us it was going to hit and cover our children's village and everything would be washed away. Our children now, not just me, sat up by our school singing and telling the wave to turn around. And it just dissipated right into the ocean. That was on the news too. Our little munchkins singing up on a hill, telling the wave to turn around. I like it. Santo Deus. I like it. I just think it's really, really neat. Nobody felt led to leave except one missionary. Everybody else just stayed and told the wave to leave. Hey, Paul says in verse 11, may you be strengthened with all power according to his glorious might for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to Daddy, Father, God, who has enabled you to share in the saints' inheritance in the light. Did you hear that? Daddy, God, has allowed all of you in this room to share in the inheritance in the light. Now that should make somebody happy. So, I'm reading these verses, I'm believing these books, I'm trusting God, and stuff happens. Difficult stuff. Like my husband lost his mind. That was kind of hard. His mind just went, bzz, disappeared. It was terrible. Cerebral malaria, mini strokes, post-traumatic stress. They chopped up people in our churches in Congo. They chopped off their feet, their breasts, their hands. His mind just, he made some bad decisions. He worked too hard. All of the stuff that happens. And his mind just disappeared. There I was. Hallelujah, Hosanna. And then our other senior leader decides this is the year that God has asked him to do nothing. Hallelujah, Hosanna. Hallelujah, Hosanna. I'm like, could you not have picked another year, brother? Nope, God said this year I'm doing nothing. So I've just lost. Out of four of us, there's now two of them out of commission. One, because God decommissioned him. told him just to do nothing. The other one, because I have no reason, understanding, really. I could try, but I don't, so never mind. So, and then, at the same time, I finally get this boat, right? And I'm reaching these unreached people groups, and my sons and daughters are going with me, and I'm really excited, and every week, deaf hear, and the blind see, and the cripple walk, and I'm happy about that. You know, meanwhile, I come home, my husband's drooling, can't put on his flip-flops, I have to bathe him and feed him and help him with every, he can't do anything. The other guy's taking a year break, and I'm just worshiping God in the midst of the storm, in the midst of the glory, in the midst of the fire, in the midst of the beauty of it all. And it is all of the above. And then this boat that I finally got to reach these people, it sinks. It sinks. I'm sitting in my boat. I take Ralphonso with me. He used to be Roland, now he's Ralphonso because he got raised from the dead. Anyway, you gotta have a new name. So I stuck Roland in the boat, and his camera, he still could do some things like hold a camera, and it falls in the ocean, and his glasses fall into the sea, and the boat sinks, you know, and I'm like, oh, Jesus. But at the same time, the people of that village built me a house. So I was really thinking, wow, the boat sunk, but the house is so beautiful. It's made out of mud, and it's just, I always wanted a mud hut, and I was so excited. And so I didn't want to hear about the boat sinking, you know. It only sunk halfway, just the engines and electronics. So I'm there, and I'm having to make a decision. What am I going to do right then? So I've got another missionary with me. A rescue ship came, but I didn't want to get on it because we wouldn't all fit on it. And I had my new house. And these people excited about God, and they had no idea what a boat would cost or that it would be difficult for it to sink. Like for me, because they figured they'd just take me back in their boat. So they didn't really consider that I might be a little tormented in my spirit. They just said, just keep going, you know, it's all good. Let's just have a meeting. So I did. And I remember this missionary hiding under a capellana saying, "You've lost your mind. Why are you preaching right now? The boat, don't you understand? The boat's sinking." I'm like, yeah. I already texted the intercessors. Now I'm going to preach. Because I'm not going to sit there and go, "Oh, God, oh, my boat's sinking. Oh, Jesus, somebody, let's cry." There were people that wanted to hear the gospel. So I just kept preaching. I preached everything I could preach in their dialect and in another language as well, another one that I knew. And I was just done. I was done. Finally go to sleep. But, you know, through that whole experience, the beautiful thing of it was they built us a fire. They warmed us with a fire. They fed us. They took care of us. They gave me my house. They, you know, they just blessed us, and I prayed. I remembered Paul. Okay, I was like, you know, shipwreck, check. I'd already been in prison, check, check, check. Stone, check, check, check. You know, but now shipwreck, check, check. And I'm just thinking, too many checks there. They're all check, check, good checks, but hey, no snakes. And I thought of no snakes, no snakes in Jesus' name. Shakababa. And I went to bed. And I was in my on my little rope bed there, and my brothers were in the other room of the hut. And I'm thinking, I prayed for no snakes, but in the middle of the night, they're screaming, "Aah!" Like babies, little men screaming like babies, fire ants. I said, "God, I should have, you know, prayed about the fire ants, but I thought that the snake would hit it." Anyway, just stuff happens, you know. And then the believers don't really consider that this, we might have had a little challenging night with the boat sinking and Roland's camera falling into the ocean, his glasses gone, and my missionaries being taken off by a drunken sea captain in a cyclone. They didn't really, you know, or the fire ants, they were just all happy because we were there and God was there and they met Jesus and they now have a school and a church and it's time to dedicate it. So at about 4 o'clock in the morning, the entire village surrounds my house. They did not put up a fence. No, no, no. They surround my mud hut, and they surround it, and they're singing with joy. Hallelujah, Hosanna. I'm like, oh, Jesus. Don't they know what we've just been through? No, they don't. They just know that they're in love with God and they know Him now and it's time to dedicate a church. The cock had not crowed. They didn't care. They were excited. I go in and I dedicate the church. We preach our hearts out and a lot of stories, but never mind. I almost died again and no time to tell you, but after that experience, the plane, we used the boat and the plane, you know, to reach people, and the trucks. Another interesting thing happened. A big truck drives into our church before it's finished, just drives in out of control and falls on its side. That's weird. It just drives in up a straight road, curves into our church, drives into our church building, and bam, falls over. Do you know what I did? Do you want to know or no? Yes? No? Okay, thanks. I was waiting on you. I was in the tent looking at this vehicle that drove up the hill, turned into my church, and falls over on its side. It is probably an 8-ton truck. And I'm me. I look at that truck. I look at the fear in the eyes of the people in the church. I see they're freaked out because witch doctors have been putting curses on us. They want us to die. And now there's stuff, all this stuff happening. And I look at their eyes just like, oh, oh. And they're kind of, some of them are starting to faint, you know. And something happened inside my spirit. It was like, no! I said, I'm going to go pick up the truck. I go rather calmly down to the truck. It's very big. And I'm me. And all these people from the church just follow me down there. They just follow me. And I'm like, Jesus! Push on this truck that has fallen over in my church. Pushing on it. Pushing, pushing. And suddenly, it goes back up. But listen, some of you think I did that. That's so cute. But what happened was, there, as I pushed on this truck, saying, we will not be moved. God is alive, and no witch doctor has the upper hand ever on us. I pushed, hundreds and hundreds of people put their hands on that truck, and together, bam, we pushed it back up. Shaka Baba. Another little challenge happened. Our plane crashed. So the boat sunk. Roland lost his mind. plane crashed. I have a bag full of prophecies and a big God who I'm in love with, and thousands of kids that are watching and learning and trusting and believing, watching how we're going to respond when stuff like this happens. The plane crashed. I got the message. I was doing a conference with Roland and George and Winnie, and they couldn't find the pilot. Plane was crashed. I went to YWAM. God said, declare and decree in front of all of these children. I call them children, young people. Declare and decree that before you get to your room, they're going to find the pilot. He's in the middle of the bush. He's been lost for 8 hours. God tells me to declare in front of all those people they're going to find the plane. So I did. I said, I'm just going to declare right now that we're going to find the pilot before I go to my room tonight. Can you stand with me? They all start crying out to God. As I get to the curb to go up to my room, here comes the text. Pilot found, still alive. Santo Deus. Hey, I pray that you would have endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father, who has enabled you to share in the saints' inheritance in the light. What is our inheritance? Yes! You got it! Some people are like, I don't know. I'm not sure. I won't be sick. Ooh, I hope. No, nations. Nations. Nations are our inheritance. That means we need vehicles to get to the nations, right? We need faith. We need minds. We need hearts. We need spirits. We need power. We need His presence. We need God. We need the presence of the Almighty God to crash in on us day and night so we can see what He has promised us, not as orphans, but as sons and daughters. When the children come into our village, they come downcast with their little heads down. They don't look you in the eyes. You ask them their dream. They are hoping maybe no one will hit them. But when you ask my sons, my daughters, their dreams, they lift up their heads all over the village. We tell all the village children, 2,500 kids in our primary school, I walk around their mud huts. They have no water, no electricity, nothing. But they now have school. They now have food. They now have a hope and a future. They know Jesus, every one of them. I lift up their heads. I say, what's your dream? They say, I'm going to be a doctor. I'm going to be a nurse. I'm going to be an engineer. I'm going to be a professor. Bam, 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 just like that. Preacher, social worker. I'm like, yes. So they watch when boats crash and planes sink and husbands lose their minds. And the way that I choose to walk in the storm matters to them. And it matters to Him. And the way I choose to walk in the storm is trusting my daddy's good all the time. And I want to end with this. Yesterday I got a text. Our senior administrator's life's been threatened 2 times yesterday. Our senior missionaries in the South, their documents have been seized. The government's taken their stuff. They've commanded that we pay 40% increase on all salaries. So you need to take a little. And I was a little bit, well, I needed a few deep breaths yesterday. And we hadn't slept really. And so I took a few deep breaths. Jesus, you're good. In the last 30 days, before I started this tour, I have seen more people come to Jesus than I have ever seen in 37 years of preaching the gospel. Hey! Glorious Jesus! And you know, we're getting there. Thank you to all of you beautiful people in the UK who helped us, because we're getting there in a new bush plane that has 10 seats and a porta potty. Come on. And we're getting there. Thank you, Mateus, and Holland, and UK, and America, and the believers of God who believe with us, because we're getting to these unreached people who in the last 30 days more have come to him, even in huge stadium meetings that I've done. More have come in this month as we've sent 20 teams throughout the nations. I keep hearing reports, it's no longer 4 deaf people hearing, it's like 50 deaf people hearing. It's no longer 5 blind people hearing, it's like 15 blind people seeing. And cripple, because it's not just one team, it's 20 teams. They just hit it, and they're going in the ship, the big boat that used to belong to the King of Spain. Now it belongs to the King of Glory. Shaka Baba. Would you stand with me, please? Guess where I took that boat? Very, very big, big boat. It's kind of scary to say yacht, so I say big boat or baby ship. But guess where I took it first? North Korea, God bless your heart. Ah, the freighter's coming. That's my declaration. I took it straight back to where we shipwrecked, of course. Shaka Baba. Got off in a dinghy that didn't need any duct tape. Straight to the people. And I said, you know that little boat that sunk. Dun, 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 dun. Here's the new one. Shaka Baba. Yay! Shaka Baba. I'm going to pray, and tonight you're going to get rocked. Randy's going to preach. He's the one that laid hands on me years ago in Toronto and asked me if I wanted a nation from God. God asked through him, and I said yes. And he's going to preach tonight. I don't want you to miss it. So I'm just going to close in prayer, and tonight we're going to pray for each other and get wrecked. Is that it? Because we need to get ready for tonight. So you're going to just hold these words in your heart, because there's no time for an altar call, nothing. You're just going to go eat. Shaka Baba. Here we are. God, you are so good, and I bless these people, God, and I thank you, Father, that you are warming up their hearts, and they are finding out that their lives, wholly given to you, are absolutely, gloriously more wonderful than they could ever have thought of or imagined. God, take their hearts and make them bigger, and let their hearts beat in rhythm with your heartbeat, and let them feel your love, and let them fix their eyes on Jesus, the author and the finisher of faith. Amen and amen. Hallelujah.